Hey guys, hello, good morning. Good morning, children. Good morning, children. Good morning. Welcome to today's YouTube Live. I am very happy to be here. Yesterday was another 3-hour session. It was very exciting. We spoke to Karunesh, Kamra, and Anubhav, if you've not seen it. I hope your Sunday is going well and everything is fine in your life and you've achieved a lot of success. And in this morning, I've done a lot, okay? I'm a very... very achieving kind of guy. I woke up in the morning. I had some coffee. I made amazing breakfast for my children. You should try it sometime. It's a breakfast which is very complicated called toast with jam. Took me almost 7 hours. Hello to Wayne D'Souza. Hello, Afnan Abrar. Hello, Avinash Uchil. Good morning to you also, my friend. Just to tell you what's happening tomorrow. Tomorrow we have a break. Monday is a break. And then Tuesday we are back with XNG, which is Varun Thakur, Kautuk Srivastav, Neville Shah, and what's his face? Adar Malik. So that's going to be fun on Tuesday. Just to tell you a couple of things that I'm up to is today I have 2 events. One is I'm doing a workshop for writing because I've written 3 books and just got commissioned for the 4th. So I'm doing a writing, quick, very 90-minute talk on writing, which is today at 6:30. Also today is at 7:30, 7:45 actually is when the show will start off Rant of the Pant 2020. So if you haven't bought your tickets, please head over to saurabpant.com, guys. It's going to be fun. Again, you can keep this podcast running by going on Instamojo or PayPal or all that stuff. If you've never seen the podcast, once again, I'll tell you how this works. I bring on guests. I ask them stupid questions. They look at me stunned. And then I look at you guys in the top chat and you guys ask me questions and the guest questions and I use those questions. If you put something on Super Chat, I will try my level best to ask them. But sometimes, as it always happens, is that you can't ask all the questions. Because if I asked every single question that you guys asked, the show would go on for 4 hours. I'm okay with that. So yeah. Gandhar Malhotra says, Saurabh bhai, aap bahut achha kaam karta hai. Dhanyavaad, dost. Kanishka Dash says, my breakfast is pancakes with potato smash, highly complicated too. Good job to you also, Kanishka. Late ho pyare, 2 minutes late is not late, yaar. What are you talking about? All right, let's, without further ado, bring on my guest who's waiting in the wings. Are they wings? I don't know. Please give a round of applause in your minds to Mr. Srinivasan Jain. Hello. Hello.
Hi,
how's it going?
Good.
I already like your backdrop. This is a true person who's dealt with news multiple times.
This is a what?
Your backdrop shows that you have a production background because it's like...
this is because we, you know, like under this weird like lockdown time, we also keep doing live shit from the house.
Yeah.
So you have like producers shouting at you, backdrop theek karo, ye ganda sa backdrop kyun de?
You know, this is, I've done 27 of these and this is the best backdrop I could find in my house.
It's
half. And my favorite thing to do is that I always keep the cupboard slightly open so that people get really pissed off by that. Like, close your cupboard. And I'm like, no, now it's entertainment. It's like the cupboard is open. How's the lockdown been treating you? As we were discussing earlier, essential services. So you guys are on the move and constantly out there.
Yeah. So, we kind of skipped the worst kind of being sequestered aspect of the lockdown.
Right.
Because we got listed with essential services. So we were out from pretty much, I think the first couple of weeks, I was going into office mostly to anchor from there. And then by the third week, my team and I were on the road.
But just reporting on all the, isn't it scary? Like, I went to buy groceries and I was like, this is scary as shit. So I can imagine having to be there constantly. Kumar Varun is also here. Hi, Kumar Varun.
Hi, Saurabh. Good morning. Hi, Srinivas. Srinivasan. Sir, I don't know. How do we address you? Should we just be casual and say Srini? Or should we just say Sir?
No, just call me. Actually, everyone calls me Vasu.
V-A-S-U. Vasu. Let's do that.
I already got Vasu privileges earlier, KV. I just wanted to tell you that.
Yeah.
So I.
Damn it. Yeah. Okay.
What do you want us to call you, Kumar? That's the question. Like.
Anything is fine. Kumar, Varun, anything, KV, anything.
I was discussing this where I have this very weird minor fantasy in my life where I want to become famous enough that I enter a party and I'm introduced to somebody and somebody just says, "Arey, inko kaun nahi janta?" That's I just want that one moment in my life where that happens.
So I have that, but I have that in reverse. So what happens is you're at an airport and a guy will do that thing where he's trying to I think he's trying to figure out is it you, and then he comes up with this family and he says, "Arey, aap." So yes, and aap to amazing hai, ye wo. Then he turns to his family and says, "Pehchana? Inko kaun nahi janta?" And the family looks absolutely blank. So you get a row of uncomfortable, you know, uncomfortable silence. And they're looking at you. They don't know who the fuck. Father is like, "Nahi, nahi, aap to jante hi hain. Kabhi kabhi bachche aajkal TV news itna dekhte nahi hain. Quickly get out of that situation."
It happens to us also, but it's mostly the reverse, where the kids are like, "Oh my God," they come, and the parents are like, "Kahan ja raha hai? Phone leke kahan ja raha hai? Iske saath kyun photo khicha raha hai? Kaun?"
I've never understood this. Occasionally, I'll be like, "Rajdeep, boss, you're too good, amazing."
And
I'm like, "Raj, I don't look anything like Rajdeep."
I'm assuming that nobody will take it. Like if you're having lunch in a canteen and somebody starts screaming at you and then you're like, "I'm not Rajdeep." That would be weird.
Rajdeep is not such a screamer actually, but...
the video where people screamed at her. Remember that dude who
screamed?
The Bangalore. I think it was Bangalore. MTR.
It's just mostly well done, Rajdeep.
By the way, already questions have started coming in, and the questions have already started questioning the whole purpose of news, which is already a great start. one Sai Krishna has asked, "In the age of internet and social media, are 24/7 news channels needed?" This is already the start which we are looking for, just to start off. It's a kind of valid question, though, no?
It is, but it also in a country like India, it isn't. I think a bulk of Indians still receive their news, as they understand it, khabar, from news channels. So if you get out of this little social media, whatever bubble that we operate in, so for the rest of the country, because what is it? Internet connectivity is still only 15-20%, right? So there's still a big chunk of people who have to look for news outside of Twitter and Facebook and whatnot. So TV news, particularly, is still sadly, given how shit it is these days, it's sadly a big influencer. And if you go outside to smaller towns and cities and villages and you say, "Aapne khabar kahan dekha?" TV pe dekha. So TV pe dekha is still like the way that even if you get some WhatsApp, some nonsense on your WhatsApp, What you still get validate, like what validates that piece of information is TV. And that's why political parties are obsessed with trying to influence and control and make sure that TV ki jo khabar aati hai, that we have to control that message. Print, digital is important, but TV is still crucial in our country.
You heard it, advertisers. Advertiser news channels, okay?
I had a related question, Saurabh. I had a related question because you talked about news consumption. I'm curious to know your, and as unbiased as it can be, on your opinion on how news consumption has changed over the years. And let me add what I mean when I say that. Mm-hmm. Is that I remember you, if I'm not wrong, you went behind the scenes in the world of journalism somewhere in the mid-90s. Okay. And since then, you've been an integral part of Indian journalism. But having said that, in terms of how the audience consumes news, especially in the last 20-25 years, how has it changed? That's my first part. Secondly, no matter how much we talk about these so-called news channels, like, I'll say the names, like Times Now and Republic, and there is, we all have very polarizing view of how Times Now and Republic sort of broadcast news. But having said that, we have to admit that they have had an impact as to how people consume news in this country. I just wanted to know from your perspective, both as an insider, and when I say insider, from this on-ground reporter back in 90s, I remember from now a managing editor, to a consumer of news yourself. How do you see the change?
Okay, so we have about 3 hours, right? Because I'm now going to...
Six hours.
So in short, when we started off, I'm talking now of TV news mainly, which I assume is you're talking about, because that's the new entry. Print has been around for much longer. So TV news, back in the day, 95, I joined NDTV, when we were just starting off doing privately produced news for Doordarshan, was still... Like it was still like it had an old school, like conventional BBC style approach to the news, right? That you have a bulletin based approach. You start with the big khabar of the day, which is probably some political news, and you end with the weather and some light, you know, what is called a soft story.
Yeah.
And there was broad consensus amongst everybody who was doing news, which in those early days was us, Aajtak and Z, and then it expanded, that that's the template for news. And there's a broad consensus on what constitutes the badi khabar, what constitutes, you know, the not so whatever, etc., etc. And there was a certain kind of sanity that was still prevailing, right? That lasted, I think, perhaps, possibly for about half a decade or a decade. And then we all went 24 hours, and then a ton of news channels started. And then the competition became so insane. So everyone is flying in formation, right? Everyone's broadly following the same khabron ka format. So you can just imagine like a squadron, everyone. The competition got so bad, and this started with the Hindi channels, and now everyone does it. They started dropping off, and then you started getting things like Sansani and, you know, those nightly crime shows?
Yeah.
Which is like incredible. And then Nag Nagin.
Yeah.
मुझे जाके रावण का गुफा मिल गया लंका में ब्रेकिंग
सो
बिफोर द टाइम्स नाउ एंड द रिपब्लिक यू नो द काइंड ऑफ नॉर्थ कोरियन बॉन्कर्स इनसैनिटी वी हैव टुडे व्हिच इज अ काइंड ऑफ मोर पॉलिटिकली ड्रिवन एजेंडा ड्रिवन काइंड ऑफ व्हाटएवर फॉर्म ऑफ न्यूज चैनल द फर्स्ट बिग ब्रेक दैट हैपेंड फ्रॉम सैनिटी एंड फ्रॉम क्रेडिबिलिटी एंड ऑल ऑफ दैट वाज व्हेन यू स्टार्टेड गेटिंग इनटू दिस टोटल टैब्लॉइड. That was the first wave of tabloidization, which people have sort of now forgotten.
Yeah.
That crime guy who came at night and was anchoring from behind.
Yeah.
That shit, we never knew. We didn't see that. I mean, we didn't see that coming. That was bizarre. Yeah. And then you had astrologers anchoring morning bulletins, etc., etc., etc. So that was the wave one.
Yeah.
That dramatically altered both like how news was generated and produced and what channels started looking like and how it was consumed, to your point. People actually started looking to news channels for that shit.
Correct.
They thought that's the way, you know, that's the new normal.
Sorry to interject just for a second. I remember...
And the second wave is this current...
But don't you think that I remember reading an interview. I don't know if this is true. But it's one of my favorite stories, which is that Rajat Sharma once said that when they started off India TV, they were trying to do all this reporting of scams, and they were trying to like uncover all this stuff, and nobody was watching. And so he decided that he's going to follow a 50-50 model, where 50% of the time it's like, hey, meri bahu alien ki saam ki bachi hai, and then it's like, let's do other stuff. And that worked out from an advertiser POV. And then sort of almost took over the landscape.
So that's, so it's coming, as I said, entirely from this incredible, it's like a completely revenue driven pressure. It's completely based on commercial considerations, right?
Yeah.
That you can't have, so in India, this is nuts, right? I keep telling people this number and they still find it hard to process. We have 800 licensed channels.
Yeah.
400 are news channels. We have 400 freaking news channels in this country, which is unsustainable. America has what? Four, five. Britain has 3, 4, right? So that's the recipe for disaster, because you can't stretch the advertising rubber band that wide. So you have to do insane things to get your ratings up. And you will then lower the bar further and further and further. So it was a completely ratings-driven, cynical move.
Okay.
And to some extent, it still is.
Yeah, go ahead, KV, please.
I just want to make 2 points there. Because you couldn't complete, because you had just finished the Sansani part and you were just entering the Times Now Republic part. And then I think we started talking about India TV. So I'll just reminding that if you wanted to say something about the last 5-6 years. Secondly, I think one factor, I know the number in India is insane compared to the West. The one big contributor to that number is also regional languages, which the US and the UK don't have. Like out of these 400, I'm sure there are so many like Bangla and Tamil and Telugu channels as well.
All of those.
So I would now or later would want your opinion as to how this vernacular media, so to speak, affects or what is their contribution to the overall landscape, news landscape in the country. Those were my 2 points. And I just couldn't help but think of that image of Sansani guy who came on screen. Chance is sona hai to jaag chahiye. That haunted me since 2011 to 13. I think those 2-3 years.
He's still there, by the way. He's still there. He's still out there every night.
Still there.
Kumar, what is the consensus? Is it Kumar or Varun? Saurabh, what do you call him?
I mean, it depends on whichever alphabet comes first in my brain. And then usually you just go with KV. By the way, Vasu, I don't know if you're familiar with Kumar Varun. He's a very, very good stand-up comedian, founder of Random Chikibam, and also an ace quiz master. And very recently, he was quoted as one of the most insightful people about Indian history by a gentleman called Veer Sanghvi.
I tell you this. I think we've done about 20 minutes of the boring stuff. Let's just have both of you crack jokes for the remaining 40 minutes, because nobody is tuning in at 11 on a Sunday morning to hear some random anchor go on about this or that shit.
I have an update for you. There's 1,000 people watching right now. There's 1,000 people watching at this moment.
Yeah, Vasu, you'll be pleasantly surprised with the kind of response we got with Ramchandra Guha interview and Veer Sanghvi interview. Pleasantly surprised for us.
Actually, I'm not that surprised. Everyone wants good content.
And also, people are sick of us making jokes. They want us to like do something else and provide another. And like, I think one of the focuses that we have is that a lot of us also for example, and this is something I wanted to get to, and I know you're sick of probably talking about it. But like what's happening in Rajasthan right now is fascinating to me, because so I wanted to come to that, because I know that a lot of us, there's so much, you know what happens with the news nowadays is that unless you start off right at the top, you lost, because the story has started from like Sachin Pilot being born, and now it's reached like some other zone where it's like there is a Rajasthani CM in Mars. So you're like, I have lost everything in the middle.
That's why it's 24 hours. It's back. It just loops back. Stick around for half an hour, 15 minutes. It'll all just loop back. So,
But you want to take KV's question? Yeah, the one which
So I think So like I was saying, that was the first wave of tabloidization, and that actually damaged like a lot of the dhancha of news and the whole kind of, you know, idea of the news as being something you trust and which is credible and serious and all of that. So that laid the ground for what happened subsequently, where now it's crazy tabloid, but it's all very driven by a certain agenda that you have to push government propaganda. You have to attack the government's rivals. You have to protect the government from criticism. And you have to basically push this weird mix of propaganda, bigotry, Hindu, Muslim, WhatsApp forward kind of insanity every night. That's the second wave of tabloidization. But that's not just only commercially driven. That's driven with also a kind of clear political agenda. So, you know, the channels which are now just, they're essentially extensions of the government or the ruling party. So some people are doing it because of a mix of ideology, because they genuinely believe in it, or because it's commercially successful. And also because you're scared shitless. You're worried that if you don't follow that line, the hammer is going to drop on you. So this is like a complete inversion of everything we've been taught in journalism, right? That basically you take on the government, you speak truth to power, you hold the man accountable, And that is both good journalism and it will get you ratings. People want to see people in power being challenged, questioned, attacked, you know, held to account. But yahan par the whole model is, you know, has turned on its head. Here, Chamchagiri sells. Chamchagiri channels actually get better ratings than non-Chamchagiri. So it's like, you know, it's like Alice through the looking glass.
What do you think about this? Like every time you put out any video on, like, so it's interesting to me to, so there's two types of videos that you will watch with NDTV journalists. Okay. One is the video on the NDTV YouTube and the comments are largely like, ha ha ha, whatever. And then there is the other side, which is that XYZ owned by XYZ. And there the comments are like, hey, bigger yeah, media and all that stuff.
Yeah.
So it's a two-part question. One is that, do you think there is any validity to people saying stuff like that? And two is that, how do you respond to that? And like, how do you deal with the constant, like the baggage that NDTV carries usually?
Right. So dude, this is like something that I've not really figured out. Okay. So a couple of things on this. Firstly, I think what tends to happen is that we tend to look at this through a false binary. The false binary is ki NDTV aur ye sab anti-BJP hain, ye pro-Congress hain, aur ye Republic wagera, ye pro-BJP hain, these are anti-Congress. Theek hai? Ye right-wing hai, ye left-wing hai. That's a false binary. It's not right versus left or Congress versus BJP. It's fake versus real. It is propaganda versus facts, right? That's the binary through which we should be looking at this. But, and this is a great strategy that, by the way, the right has adopted the world over. The way that you discredit liberal media is by not saying that these guys are actually telling you the facts while we are distorting them. These guys are basically just presenting you one side of the truth. It's one-sided. It's left-wing. It is pro-Hillary. It is pro-Congress, whatever. So then you stop looking at it through that lens. So no matter what I say, I can fact-check myself till I'm blue in the face. But it's already been discredited as coming from an agenda. So it's like, you're the NDTV, so you're the bole guys, right? Mm-hmm. Even if you're presenting facts. So that's one way in which you muddy the waters as to how you differentiate between, you know, what is reality and what is fiction. And we know that there is something called a verifiable truth, right? Not everything is up for debate. Like Obama was not an African citizen. He was an American citizen. But the falsehood that he was African was so widely disseminated that it actually took root in people's minds. And even if they're seeing verifiable facts telling you he's actually American, they're not believing it. So that's one part of the problem. The other part of the problem, if you ask me how you deal with this constant shit about NDTV being agenda driven, is that, look, speaking for myself, in a sense, my conscience is clear because I know what we were doing during the UPA years. I know the reporting we did about the UPA scams, whether it was the coal scam, it was 2G, jahan pe Congress ki state government ki sarkar thi, Maharashtra, Bombay, where you're sitting. There was a big irrigation scam, if you remember.
Yeah, yeah.
All that stuff. Goa, there was a Congress government involved in a huge... So for us, it was just, okay, you're in power. You're fair game. We come after you. Now, the other guy's in power. So we hold them to account. But that's not... That whole world has changed. So earlier, you could still criticize, like when the BJP government, Vajpayee's government was in power, you could still criticize them. You wouldn't get this amount of hate and, I mean, you would, right? You would still be called Congressy and all of that. But you wouldn't get this amount of shit. Now it's out of control. So sometimes I feel that maybe I should do a kind of whataboutry catalog. You know, they say, hamesha kehte hain ki, bhai, tum Congress ke, tum ye BJP ko bata rahe ho, what about Congress? Jab Congress power mein thi, tum kya kar rahe the? So I thought maybe I'll do a whataboutry catalog where I list all the stories I did during the UPA time. Yeah. What about 1984? These are my 1984 stories. What about 2G? These are my 2G ke stories. These are my Robert Vadra ke ghotale stories. These are coal scam stories. Hai. Aap, once and for all, I'll show it to you. You go and see it in your mind. And then leave me alone.
But I mean, that's a great idea. But that's generally like something that I think, I mean, just, I mean, forget like whichever side you're on, just from a content POV, that's a fun thing to watch. Right? It's just yeah. like, the
catalog
what about
like, political party? Ye Mayawati ke, ye sare anti Mayawati stories hai, ye anti Samajwadi stories hai.
I mean, I actually won't even get into this because it's going to lead to people going ballistic about other stuff. Akavi, you have any questions or should I take?
Yeah, I'll always have questions.
No, it's so weird. Just wanted to say,
yeah,
it's so weird when nowadays, because when you get trolled by even by BJP leaders, all these people during the UPA years, they would all come on our shows. And when we would do this or that khulasa, they'd be like, wow, sir, kya aapne khulasa kar diya, and aap to bas ye hai, wo hai. And now, so I literally want to pull out those clips and put them on. But then you think, oh, maybe I'm coming across as knee-jerk or defensive, and why should I pander to the, you know, the mob and all of that. So, I don't know. But maybe after getting your guys' responses, I'll kar dete.
Yeah. I next wanted to ask, just wanted to lighten up this thing a bit because Vasu also said ki bahut bahut serious ho raha hai aur hum log sirf journalism ki baat kar rahe, so I have a very different angle to this, okay? What I want to know is that in any industry there's always this crop of people who have come from one place and they've all distributed and started doing your own thing, you know. Even in things like army, you'll be like, hey, you're NDA which batch? Oh, I am in this batch. Even in comedy, we have things like, oh, you used to do Canvas Laugh Factory at this stage, or used to work with whatever Veer Das's team at this point, or whatever.
Right.
Having been a viewer of Indian news media for like 20 years now, I know that a lot of the current top names have all started at New Delhi Television, NDTV, right? Mm-hmm. Wherein I remember, I see any face and it takes me back to the late 90s era. At 7 p.m. I used to remember Hindi mein Pankaj Pachauri used to come. You know, I remember all these days of you on the road and Rajdeep trying to, and Arnab of all people. Yeah. So I remember, so, you know, all this, it feels to me in my mind, it's like a college that all of you were part of. And I'm just visualizing all of you sitting in a canteen and saying, oh, kya bola? Are tere din mein Vajpayee gir gaya. Oh, what are you saying? Jalalitha. Oh God. Bhuta Singh is voting. Oh my God. What are you saying? Pokhran has just happened. What the? Yeah, I just imagine all of you as like postgraduate students sitting and chilling and talking about, oh my God, did you hear it? There might be a war in Kargil. What are you saying? Barkha, are you going to Kargil? No, I might not. I don't know. So I imagine all these people. And now, after almost 20 years, all of you are being painted in different prism of right and left and corporate and Godi media, Litians media, and whatnot. Somebody's writing for Washington Post, somebody's doing Ravish a report at 9. And all of you, in my mind, are those young reporters on the streets in 99, 90. No, as in younger.
The okay. moment you said early 90s, half your audience went, what? Early 90s?
No, late 90s.
Yeah.
So I just want to know how it feels in your mind when you get sort of think about those days, or when you guys meet. You know, there is lot of chatter about Arnab versus the others and all that. But you know, you've all been colleagues at some point, and you all know that you used to, you know, hang out and report to Pranav Roy together.
Yeah. So yeah, I can't fully describe to you what those early days were like because we've all signed non-disclosure agreements. So
Discipline,
by the way, I was non-disclosure agreement.
Yeah, you had to bring NDA even in this question. I know you had to bring NDA.
You talked about non-disclosure. You know, KV, both of us were like, who's going to make this joke first?
I took the bait, Saurav. It's your channel, so I will take the bait.
people keep asking about Arnab, and the answer is, it's a very anticlimactic answer. Like he was just like a, you know, everyone's just like a normal dude. Like, we're all just idiots trying to figure out what the hell is going on most of the time. Aapas mein lad jhagad ke ye sab chal raha hai, jo bhi hai, koi ye kar raha hai, wo kar raha hai. But there was no sense that he or anybody would then go on and become X or Y personality. And so that's why when you see him now shouting and screaming, it's so hard to reconcile it with the, you know, that earlier avatar where you're just like any other guy. And I suspect, because I haven't met him for a very long time, that I suspect if you meet him at an airport or wherever, he'll actually just be like, hey, what's up?
You know? Yeah.
So it's like this kind of, almost like a kind of manufactured persona where you go, and then it's like, hey, kya ho raha hai aajkal? You know?
Yeah.
So it's, I'm always, I'm reminded of like, you know, Apta Chappan, where like Nana Patekar is like in the middle of an encounter and like bullets are flying, and then his wife calls and says, "Acha, aaj thoda na kanda, thoda tomato, thoda aloo de lena." And he's like, "Haan, haan, theek hai." And then, So, yeah, I think a lot of these kind of, I don't know what to put it, like these, like quote unquote monstrous figures that you think of. And I don't want to drop names, but I met Trump. I met Trump on an assignment, so I kind of dropped names. humble bragging name has been introduced. Yeah. And you meet him, and with all the, and then you actually, it's a very banal kind of thing. He's like, "Hey, you know, nice to meet you. Yeah, India's a great country. You must build a relation and go forward." Done, out. So the graph is sort of...
It seems like an onstage persona, because I remember doing a debate, and I've done a bunch of debates because I was like, I just find it all fascinating. And I remember doing a debate, and before the debate began, it was like the standard prototype of every debate is what I say, that there's somebody from the BJP, somebody from the Congress,
correct,
somebody from a regional party, and then one person who's an expert, and then some random person like me.
Yeah.
And what was happening was that the regional party and Congress and BJP, before the debate began, I see them sitting and having a cup of chai, and they're like, "Oh, you didn't go to Meena's Shadi," and this is like all this chilled chat, and everybody's like, whatever.
Yeah.
And then second the camera's on, everybody's trying to like basically give each other rabies. I'm like, this is insane. That there is a lot of onstage persona to this.
No, it is. There's like a whole kind of, it's like a theater, right? This is a new theater. Every night you want to watch drama. So everyone has come as a caricatured version of themselves. Angry right-wing guy, some extreme Maulana, jo pure Maulana ke matlab, he has to also look like a Maulana. It's not enough that he's a Maulana. He has to look like... And then you have each of these stock characters, and they come on and they perform. And then once the parda lifts, then everyone's like, "Hey, dude, what's up? This, that." So, yeah, I've seen that for years, and in a way we're part of it, because we also have to kind of present this sense of we're holding them to account and we're questioning them and all of that. But at the end of the day, you can't push it beyond a point, because there's an unspoken consensus that you're all playing along, and you can't kind of rattle the boat too much. And actually that's my problem with this whole debate idea, right? There's this kind of false idea that what you are, as a viewer, seeing is a debate. That you get perspective A, perspective B, all of that. And you, I think you guys may have seen that Jon Stewart takedown of CNN. You remember that?
Yeah.
So Jon Stewart took down, I think it was called hot something, like, I can't remember the name of the show, but it was called Firing Guns. Or all the shows on CNN were named like that.
All about
Hamaka and fire and hot something and burning seed and things like that. And he said this left versus right is meaningless, because as a viewer, you don't get to know. Your job is to look at the facts and tell them that based on this, this guy is right and this guy is wrong, or this guy is lying and this guy is not. You're not supposed to draw this equivalence. And the analogy he uses, which I always remember, he says it's like getting the guy from Coke and Pepsi. And the guy says, Coke is best. And the Pepsi guy says, "No, Pepsi is the best." And the anchor is like, "Well, there you heard it. You know, I leave it to you to judge what's best. That's all we have. That's all the time we have." That's not journalism, right? Journalism is like basically lifting the lid on these claims and saying, "Okay, we have tested Coke, we have tested Pepsi, and based on our whatever, this, you know, this is what it is." So a lot of what people are consuming as debate, and they feel, "Oh, I'm getting to hear both sides."
Yeah.
You're not. Yeah. And you shouldn't be asking for that. You should be asking for what is the closest verifiable truth or fact about this issue.
And it's the role of journalists in these cases has to be like Vasu said, with like facts which are undeniable, which he referred to earlier, wherein if I'm the journalist, I'll be like, "Hey, I went to 100 people and it did blind testing. 61 said they like Coke, 38 said they like a Pepsi, and one of them could not decide. Now, what is your opinion on that?" You know, that is that. And when I added the Coke logo, this is how the opinion changed, which is the power of your brand. You know, right. These are the things that the moderator and slash the presenter has to bring. Otherwise, there's no point.
Because what power wants is they want the theater. They want this false equivalence. कि भाई ये साइड भी है वो साइड भी है हाँ भैया तो अरे हाँ ये भी था वो भी था रेप सही भी रेप गलत है सही भी हो सकता यू नो एवरीथिंग इज नॉट अ ग्रे सो इफ समबडी सेज रोहिंग्याज आर टेररिस्ट यू डोंट गेट अ गाय ऑन सेइंग रोहिंग्याज आर टेररिस्ट द अदर गाय इज लाइक दे नॉट टेररिस्ट एंड द एंकर इज लाइक वेल व्हाट डू यू नो यू हर्ड बोथ साइड्स फोक्स मेक अप योर माइंड नो यू हैव टू गो आउट एंड एस्टैब्लिश इज देयर एनी एविडेंस टू बैक द वेरी वेरी इंसेंडरी क्लेम दैट रोहिंग्याज द होल पीपल आर टेररिस्ट And then you come back and say, we went and we checked it out. We've done our investigation. We went to all the police thanas where Rohingyas live. And we looked at the police records and said, are there any FIRs filed against Rohingyas for terrorist activity? 99.9% said no. Based on that, this claim appears to be misleading or an outright lie. Then you call the guy who's made that claim on the show. Then it's not a debate. Then you confront him with the facts and say, boss, tum to bol rahe ho terrorist hai, evidence hai nahi. Now, what do you have to say?
Yeah.
Most likely, he will have nothing to say. But that's the whole, that's really the whole purpose of what journalism should be doing. But nahi ho raha. Not enough.
Okay, I'm going to take some questions from Super Chat because people are getting very overexcited. Just some statements have come. Madhav Pangarkar says, KV sir, aapko kaun nahi janta? So there you go for KV. That's just a statement for you. Abhishek Patil says, I watch NDTV for news and other news channels for entertainment. Rohan Beer Singh Dhaliwal has a question, which is, will news ever be facts instead of opinions again? I think there's plenty of news channels which are facts and plenty which are opinion. I don't think there's a one.
So again, false binary, right? When you think of Republic or when you think of opinion, you immediately think of the what we call the North Korean channels or Godi Media, Republic, Times, Nazi. These guys are not giving you opinion in that sense. They are actually telling you their what they think is their factual view. They don't do both sides. Hey, ye bhi hai, wo bhi hai. Their whole thing is to basically, as I said, find ways of presenting the news so that it is always in defense of the government. It is always critical of the opposition. Or is trying to constantly portray Hindu grievance, majority grievance. It's always Hindu khatre mein hai, right? That's the take. So you have to twist the facts and distort or whatever to make sure that it is always taking that line. So in some ways, in a weird way, these guys are actually doing what journalism should be doing, which is to tell you, ki bhai, ye jo hua hai ghatna, what is your takeaway from it? This is what it is. Corona phaila hai because of the तबलीग मुसलमान ने फैलाया कोरोना ये हम आपको फैक्ट बता रहे हैं ये ओपिनियन नहीं है वी आर टेलिंग यू द फैक्ट देन यू कॉल 10 पीपल एंड यू हैव अ डिबेट व्हिच इज ऑल टिल्टेड टुवर्ड्स दैट सेम साइड सो दिस इज नॉट अ काइंड ऑफ फ्री थिएटर ऑफ यू नो डेमोक्रेसी ऑफ आइडियाज ये भी है वो भी है नो दे आर वेरी वेरी क्लियर ऑन व्हाट द लाइन इज एंड हाउ टू पुश इट एंड एक्चुअली The so-called liberal media is still trying to do this balance of ideas. Ki inko bhi bula lijiye. That's not the way that you contest falsehoods and you know misinformation. You have to counter that and say we have done our own check, and this is what it is.
I have a weird sort of question about this. I think there's a lot of the the right-left kind of thing. And the impression is that the right keeps putting out falsehoods and stuff like that. But don't you think there are plenty of people on the right who are also like who thought out and researched stuff? I mean, it's not entirely based on fiction.
Like who?
That's why I'm asking you.
So it's a huge challenge for us because every time we try to have a discussion or whatever, we try to call. You know, kind of people, thinkers, intellectuals, academics, whatever you want to call it, from the right, who will come and speak with sanity. Ye nahi ki aap aate hi maro, kaato, mandir, masjid. And that pool is shrinking rapidly. Like there was a time when you could still find someone who's, you know, kind of a right wing or a conservative thinker. But it's very hard to come across them now. Some of them have been absorbed into the government or have sort of left the scene, or the others have become so rabid that you can't even recognize them. And so it's very hard. And listen, this is not to say that the other side, the left or the other political shades are not doing falsehoods and fake news, right? Power ultimately looks and looks for bad practices which are working and moves towards that. So, you know, BJP bad practices are built on Congress bad practices, and which will now, so, and the Congress will build on that, and then upwards we go. It's just that the right felt that the mainstream media, the mainstream avenues of information were not open to them. So we will create alternative facts and alternative channels, and we will kind of use that. And once there's a cycle turns, and let's say at some point the right is no longer in power, the other side is, they will build on all these bad practices, and they're doing that already. So like, if you look at regional parties, they're no great defenders of free speech, right? Mm-hmm. Or wherever the Congress is in power, you hear journalists being harassed, they'll be thrown in jail, there'll be, you know, sedition charges against people who post on Facebook. You hear that from Mamta, you hear that from Jagan, you hear that from Congress government. But right now, because the world over, there's this kind of upsurge of the right, they are taking the lead in all these bad practices.
Listen, just a couple of questions, and I'm sure that KV has a lot of questions to ask. Kuch Bhi Mehta, Akash Mehta asks, India TV color scheme switched from red to orange in 2014. Koinki dink tell. What? Coincidence is what he meant. He's written this as Koinki dink. I'm like, wow, what a weird error of writing. I generally thought, I read Koinki dink and I'm like, maybe this is some journalism term. Like, this is something I missed out.
Or some new age internet lingo that we are not aware of.
Anshul Bhamra says, share your experience on Mossad rocket investigation in Israel and aftermath. You're awesome.
Can I ask you guys a question?
Yes, sir.
So how is it, like in this time, have you guys, like, how has comedy been? Has comedy, like, do you, because I know comedians get shit as well, right? Like, just look what happened recently to those comedians in Bombay. Do you pull your punches now much more than you did earlier?
Because we discussed this in, I think,
Ramchandra Guha and Veer Sangvi.
Guha,
and you
Guha
and,
oh, okay,
okay.
Same question.
Yeah.
And so,
we can pass if you already done this.
It's, I mean, you deserve answers from us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You deserve. I honestly, I've always, I still stand by the fact that it's always been roughly the same, and I genuinely do think that it's a dual thing for whether it's comedians or journalists or whatever, which is that A, there are a lot of laws that are not in favor of free speech in India, which is a fact, and also I don't think there is I'm absolutely fine with somebody disagreeing with something that I said. But this normalization of violence as the response to that is something that needs to be investigated properly. You know what I'm saying?
You're not answering my question.
Yeah. No, but I've the thing is that in general, the reason why we punch, and I've been pulling my punches for a while, and it's not because I don't think it's actually about pulling your punches. It's about being slightly smarter in what you're trying to communicate.
But you feel the need to do that. That's what I'm going to get at. Like, hopefully.
But that's the case in any country. I don't think there's a single country in the world that is not like that. I do think that in India, there's a lot. Yeah.
America isn't. But that's...
That's the only country.
Yeah.
And that's the only country in the world. And this is like, I know that people will start off with this thing about like, oh, you don't like India. I'm like, that's the only country in the world. I'm not saying like in India, you can't. And in Bangladesh, you can. I'm just saying that in America is the only country where freedom of speech is an absolute right. In every other country, it comes with caveats, whether it's from the left or the right or whatever it is.
What about you, Kumar? Been pulling? However you want to describe it.
I think we you touched upon what a problem that us as a community are also facing, which is the white whataboutrika thing. A lot of people, and in fact, me too, I started doing comedy when NDA was in power. But a lot of the audience, which is on Twitter and which is on YouTube and which are coming to our live audiences, have not seen a lot of comedians before 2014. Like Saurabh, I'm sure, had same number or even more jokes about Rahul Gandhi, about Manmohan Singh, about UPA. But people have not seen them do this. I mean, I say them, I mean senior comics like Saurabh and like Tanmayas and AIB and everyone. I'm sure they had enough to do. But every time they see them cracking a joke about Modi or the current government, they feel all of us are anti-Modi, which is the sad part. And I think even Saurabh should follow what Vasu told about making a manual.
Let's go, what about the...
Oh, by the way, I did this. I literally did this. So there was a point in the middle where somebody was like, you only make jokes on Hindus. And I'm like, that's not even close to the truth. My most popular video was a video called Muslim Names. And one of my top 10 most popular videos was a divisive thing about Hindu versus Muslim. There's an entire section that I'd done about population, which was about the growing population, specifically in like Muslim areas, and followed by like stuff about the same thing, right? And I'm like, so I kept a whole list of videos. And then after a point, I gave up and stopped. And again, I started in 2008. And back then, I used to play a character on stage called Panmohan Singh, which was just me dressed as Manmohan making bad puns about Sonia Gandhi. It was horrible. But we used to do like a lot of absolute nonsense, which is like...
That's the weird thing, that you have to kind of audit yourself now.
Yeah.
You have to do a self-audit and say, boss, maine wo, wahan usko, wo bola tha, tab ye kiya tha. And then some of it, as Kumar, you were saying, is asking you, what about when they ask me, what about 1984? Dude, I was like, in 1984, I was 13 years old. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, yeah. What do you... Where does the line stop?
Yeah.
So it's
a weird thing where it's like the line keeps... I did a debate ages back for Times of India, which was in Calcutta, where the topic was, should freedom of speech be an absolute right? And when I entered the debate, I was like, I don't think so. I mean, it's like whatever. And then as the debate went on, I was like, yeah, it should. It should actually be an absolute right. Because I, again, Mr. Guha also mentioned this, where he's like, Vajpayee had said that kitab ka jawab kitab se do. Which is still something that I think is relevant in whatever. I just find a problem with like people saying that, hey, you can make fun of the government. And then you're like, okay, I made fun of the government. Then you're like, but also make fun of the other government. I'm like, but they're not in power. how many jokes can I do on the Congress when they're in, and they're barely struggling to hold power in...
And today's version of Kitab Ka Jawab, Kitab Ka Jawab will be two guys holding like a bulky, you know, like a...
But I also come from a POV where I'm like, I'm still trying to understand, and this has always been the case. It's not been about only left, right or whatever else. I'm also trying to understand, you know, the learning. And I had this learning relatively early about people in India take religion very seriously. And I had this learning very early in my career because I talk to such people. And I completely, like, one part of me is like, you know what, I understand that it holds something in your heart.
Yeah.
And which is fine. I mean, I'm not going to do the jokes about it, not out of fear, but because I don't want anybody to feel that bad about something else. But again, the thing is that one of the jokes that led to people sending me 19 death threats is a joke that I will probably WhatsApp you, but it's barely a joke that warranted 19 death threats. And KV will know this, that people get death threats in India for all sorts of bullshit.
Yeah.
A particular comedian that we know got death threats for making fun of DJs. So the line is just just anything. There is like...
Correct.
Yeah.
There'll immediately be like a support group for DJs, that is like some DJ something, Sena. DJ Sena will come and start burning your effigy.
DJ Sena sounds like a great house party.
The whole point of this goes back to what I was saying, that you have to manufacture grievance, right?
Right.
So obviously people are religious or unme bhakti hai, this and that. But that's not good enough for you to actually act on that in terms of your voting behavior or attacking someone who you think is like speaking critically of your religion, is to whip up this hysteria ki aapki religion khatre mein hai. Aapke religion ka apman hua hai. And I completely understand that we're a deeply religious society. We're very conservative about things like religion, caste, and all of that. And you can't be in some little, your own elite bubble and talk down to that. Right? You have to accept and engage with it. But you can certainly question the amplification, the falsehoods around it. this constant khatra business, if you talk to any kind of reasonable devout Hindu, for example, and say, ki, boss, aap khatre mein ho. Aapko kya khatra hai? Is there something that is preventing you from going out and praying, practicing your religion? Do you face any discrimination on the basis of it? Are you not getting a job because you're a Hindu? Are you not getting a house to rent because you're a Hindu? What is, like, where is the problem? And you find very quickly that there are no answers, right? It's just, you've just been almost brainwashed into this idea that, sure, there may have been a time where perhaps this kind of Nehruvian idea that you will keep religion at a distance and, you know, perceiving religion, religious beliefs, practices with a certain distaste has created a sense of grievance amongst a section of the population. So you take that core grievance and then you just amplify it and amplify it into something huge and monstrous. And so it's important to keep pushing back and saying, tell us, kya khatra hai aapko? And yeah, and you often you may just be met with silence.
Okay. And oh, by the way, the water battery is already started in the comments.
Yeah, obviously.
Which is fine. And by the way, you're absolutely fine to do whatever water battery, whatever you want to say, just say. It's absolutely fine to question anything that you want. Just don't get into threats and don't get into, like, you know what? I'm fully aware of the fact that my background and everything I am as a person will paint who I am. You know what I'm saying? And with whatever prejudices, with whatever else that I have in it. But just, like, I think a lot of the times people are very unaware of the fact that that is where they're coming from, which I find very strange. Okay, let's take a few questions. We've already covered this, but again, it's a question that I'm sure you expect. Gautam Srivastava asks, is the former elite NDTV CNN 18 responsible for the current situation in terms of how anchors like Barkha were unfair to the right wing? I mean, I'm assuming this question is like a repeated. I think we covered it already.
I don't even fully understand it, actually, to be honest.
Yeah. I think we covered it. I mean, how many times have we. Anyway. Okay. Sonali Chug asks, Srinivasan did a fantastic coverage of Gaza. There's a fall in such reportage. Does he think that conflicts / war reporting is dead?
No, dude. Conflict, war reporting is not dead. We look at how everyone covered the China, I don't know whatever you want to call it, war or whatever, jhagda, skirmish.
Skirmish.
But covering international conflicts, like getting, like for an Indian journalist like myself to get flown to Gaza to cover the, you know, this was in 2014, that was anyway a rarity because paisa nahi hai sabke paas to finance this kind of stuff. So that's come down a lot. But back in the day, it's true that, you know, I got sent to Afghanistan, to Gaza, to Sri Lanka, you know, to cover the war. So it's just a function of, a lot of it has to do with paisa and with priorities. So yeah, would love to do it. Would love to go back.
KV, please.
You talked about, when you were talking about Rohingyas, you touched upon investigative journalism, because you said about how one a journalist is supposed to go out in the field and do actual investigation. And investigative journalism is something that is inspiring to a lot of people, and especially journalists, someone who is starting journalism. And in India, we talk a lot about the good old days of Indian Express versus Ambani's, or like or like Arun Shauri, or like Bofors and Chitra Subramanian, and that 80s for that matter is quoted a lot as peak of Indian investigative journalism. And right. You in 80s were young, as you rightly said, you were 13 in 84, so you were in your teens in 80s, and you were growing up. I just want to know, as someone growing up and as someone who became a big journalist, did you see or did you look up to any particular acts of investigative journalism that inspired you and that you thought are benchmark in Indian journalism history, and you know, yeah, something like that. Inspiring.
Yeah, to be dead honest, at that age, you know how it is, dude. No one knows what they want to become. I certainly had no clue I wanted to be a journalist.
Yeah,
but I mean, I was aware of people like Arun Shauri. I was aware of the Bofors investigation. So all of that was there, but it was not, you know, the Indian Express did an incredible series on booth capturing. Yeah. In Bihar and Haryana.
Yeah, yeah.
So, wo sari cheeze thi, but at that age, you're just...
I know.
You're just... Yeah. To be honest, I didn't even have a clear plan of becoming a journalist. It's just one of those things, like a billiards ball thing. You just bounce off different things and then you ricochet and then you end up somewhere.
Correct. So, but just to add to that, but then when you enter a field, you start knowing more about the field. For example, say Saurabh and I in our teens were not sure that we'll become comedians. But when we started doing comedy, we started following comedy. And then we started finding our inspiration, saying, oh my God, this is what I need to achieve. So say in the 90s or when you were in 20, when you knew that you were going to be a journalist, are there any acts or are there any benchmarks in journalism that inspired you?
So, you know, at that stage, again, when you start off, like, doing investigative work and all that comes later. You're just trying to keep your head above water to make sure that if I get this beat, so I don't miss any story, otherwise the next day my band will play.
Basically
doing daily ass protection. So for us, actually, it was Indian Express. And I think in some ways it's not changed. Indian Express is the journalist paper, right? It's like the reporter's reporter. So everybody... the first thing you would wake up is the front page of the Express. You see koi story to miss nahi ho gaya. And inevitably, you would see, they would have scooped you for something. And then you're like, aaj to boss lag gayi. Puri tarah se. So that was pretty much the benchmark in terms of a newspaper that was always trying to break stories. They weren't just happy with covering stories by routine. And so they were trying to break stories. And then... obviously, people like Shekhar, who was, you know, at that time, he was helming Indian Express, things like that. As you evolve as a journalist, you get more exposed to international stuff. So then you start looking at things that you know, they're doing outside the country, and then you also learn newer ways of tools of how to like unearth stories. Like there's this incredible, I mean, there's so many examples, not just abroad but even in India. But I, if you don't know, if heard of Rukmini Kalimaki at the New York Times, so she's been on the ISIS beat for a very long time. And it's just incredible. Like some of the stuff she does is you're not just reporting on war and conflict and terror groups, but you're going like much beyond that. So she managed to go and amass basically like documents that try to tell you the story of how ISIS functioned as a government, as a bureaucracy, because ISIS is also a terrorist group. They're also running a country. So what happens when a bunch of completely insane, you know, terrorists are actually also still, you know, doing mundane things like, bhaiya, isko parking lot ka allotment dena hai, ration ka wo procure karke uska thoda sa siphoning off bhi karna hai. All the kind of the drudgery and the daily functioning of a bureaucracy, how does that work with an evil, you know, regime, like ISIS? And so she had this great example of how she went in after the, you know, the government, the sort of parts of Iraq, which were under ISIS control, were getting quote unquote liberated. And she was embedded with the US forces. And so she went into some of these government offices, like it's not something you'd immediately think. When you enter, you're always looking for like more dramatic stuff. And she just found these old government papers lying around, you know, files, right? Jalani Pai, whatever, and chhod ke bhaag gaye. She literally started stuffing it into facts and took it back to New York. And then they analyzed it, translated it. And you get this incredible picture of the caliphate as a sort of, you know, like a regime. So, you know, things like that.
Saurabh, I have two quick points to make before you go to the audience. Okay, one is a fun fact as a quizzer I can't help sharing. The second is a question. Okay, the fun fact is on ISIS. Okay, it's incredible the kind of things that are happening here. And one of the things that fascinates me is that so archaeologically, there are so many doubts, right, in that region about like, say, where were Hanging Gardens of Babylon? What about this and all that? One of the biggest help, and for lack of a better word, that ISIS has done to the world of archaeology is that they've done so many bomb blasts that now people have unearthed, like literally unearthed things to figure out a lot of mysteries of the past. you know, there are a lot of mysteries about which river fed Hanging Garden of Babylon and where and all that. Because of ISIS, I can't believe it. It's so funny that ISIS has helped unearth mysteries of the past. And people are like, oh, achha, ye yahan pe tha. It wasn't even intentional. It's just that unhone bomb se sab uda diya, so they can see it now. Okay. My second part is from the Indian Express thing, which I wanted to ask Srinivas quickly. Is whenever we talk about Indian Express, we invariably also talk about the Goenkas, right? Which backed Indian Express, which sort of gave a lot of independence to the journalists, young journalists like Arun Shori, for instance, and the entire polyester war against Ambanis and all that. So my question leads from there is to every print media or even TV media is also backed by a corporate, right? Yes. We know that Hindustan Times has Birla and all that and so on.
Yes.
What do you think is the role and the importance as to how much backing, so to speak, or how much independence does a corporate house?
That's a great question. That's okay. By the way, 12 baj gaye, Saurabh. So anyway, when we maybe just do one.
Let me know when you want to go, and we'll just end it.
Maybe just one more question after this, and then we can.
Okay, great.
We can So Kumar, that's a great point, because actually, what's happening now, the reason why the media is so badly compromised right now is. Not because, so like in the West, when you think of media or other countries, you think of media under assault, it's a much more like overt assault. Journalists are being arrested, kidnapped, murdered, etc., etc. Like in Turkey, in Iran, in Philippines. In India, it's not as if that's not happening. Journalists are being killed, etc., etc. But that's not the real threat. What we are seeing is a kind of bloodless coup, which is happening in newsroom after newsroom, where quietly, right, without too much fuss or whatever, because of owner intervention, you'll find ki the channel has changed its line, or an anchor has been sacked, or an editor has been sacked, or moved to some other slot where he's not, or he or she is not creating a problem, or a story has been quietly killed. So this is a kind of, like they say, in the jungle, mein more nache type of thing. You don't see it, so it doesn't provoke that kind of outrage. If you shoot a journalist, it immediately, you'll have the whole world jumping on you and saying, "Dekho India mein kya ho raha hai, journalist maar gaya, blah, blah." Like sort of happened with Gauri Lankesh. But if you sack a journalist or take him off or her or him off of a show or a killer story, the noise will be much less because no one knows about it. Or if they find out, there'll be a doubt. Achha, shayad kuch aur wajah hogi, some internal issue. He was not delivering enough ratings, whatever. So this has happened because promoter after promoter, who back in the day would, even if they're not a Goenka kind of, chhati kholke, they'd largely, chalao thoda, thoko bhi sarkar ko thoda sa, dekh bhi lena, how it is. But now, the current regime is not okay with that. They want full sashtang, pura prostrate karo. So, hence, the promoter's role has become crucial, and sadly, most promoters, particularly TV channels, barring a few exceptions like NDTV, have done the full sashtang. It's all, and wherever there's been an issue, jahan bhi thoda laga ki line, like if you remember with ABP News, it happened some time ago. They're going off script, bam.
Yeah.
One phone call, one something, you cut off, disrupt their cable, 6 feet. Immediately the channel comes back into line.
Yeah.
So this is a big problem.
So that's a reality, isn't it? That's like
it's sadly a reality. You need basically what journalism needs is clean money which is largely with limited strings. There are always going to be strings, but there's a difference between saying I have a sacred cow, one sacred cow, and I have a herd of 100 sacred cows, right? So you want a Malik who is not the 100 sacred cow Malik, and who will have a certain anatomical part of organ of the body required to stand up to pressure, right? You need big, because 11 in the morning.
You can say it. Cheekbones, earlobes.
Bicep, yeah. Quads.
Quads, you need big quads to stand up. You need giant triceps.
You need to stand up. Dude, right. This is like, this is democracy. Like, don't know. So that's what you need. And unfortunately, hamare thode se wo nikle, paper tigers.
Okay, there's just a few statements and then this very important question somebody's asked you. This is the last one. I'll just read some statements. Dipshekar, sorry, we can't take a question. Sounds like a long one. Sukanto Mukherjee, thanks. Somebody says, whenever Srinivas smiles, he reminds me of Kamal Hassan, which is, you're by the way, the second guest we've had who people get reminded of Kamal Hassan.
Okay, this is a planted thing, by the way. I made sure that Ekad thode se
wo bhi karte. But what about Rajnikant? What about Padinar?
Yeah.
Sampath Ji makes a statement, with the arrival of podcasts, people have realized debates are as useless as Rohan Gavaskar in a cricket team. Debates are just a bit of laugh and time pass. I don't think Rohan Gavaskar was that bad a cricketer. It's been like, it wasn't that bad.
It's debatable.
Yeah. Soumya Ranjan Nayak says, Srinivasan is the most handsome Indian Jono.
Wow.
Thank you. And PTM, I will.
Vethi's Japa says, love you, KVN Pan. Thanks a lot. Akshat Anand asks a very important question to me, which is, can you whistle from that gap? And I'll be happy to tell you that the answer is yes. Wait, it's not happening right now. I got nervous performing with my gap. Okay, Gaurav Thatoy, I don't think you have time to take your question. Apologies for that. Rupesh Chalwani, respect to Shree for being the real journalist. I'm a liberal and we will win. Oh, I don't think there's any victories in this in the long run. It's just like nobody wins, really.
Yeah. Everyone dies.
Okay, now, Sanket Arlekar asks, what's your opinion on Vasu, on Socrates and Plato? Let's ignore that and come to the real question from Ankit Jha.
Okay.
What are his guilty pleasures? Has he watched Gunda? This is a very important
question. That's a great question.
It's a very important question. I think we have
guilty
to know.
Pleasures. Pleasures. That's a tough one. I think it's kind of banal. It's just you. It's like a YouTube, like going down YouTube rabbit holes. So there was a whole phase where I was just watching people, videos of people making steak. Like just steak bana rahe hain videos. It's just like the same thing. And it just goes from one to the next. And right now, I'm in a weird, you know, Curb Your Enthusiasm, right?
Yeah.
I'm in this weird, like, I can't watch it. Like, I can't watch the whole show. But I can, like, they just, like, the YouTube clips.
Yeah.
Larry David YouTube clips.
I recommend one of my YouTube guilty pleasures is a guy who has a hydraulic press. And he puts random things in the hydraulic press and crushes them. And I've watched hours and hours of just, he's like, what we do with a paper can? And he puts a paper can. What we do with paper? What we do with another hydraulic press? And I'm like, this is the dumbest shit to watch. So, yeah. Anyway, Srinivasan, thank you so much for the time. Really appreciate all the time you've taken. And we'll keep watching you on NDTV and all the rest of that stuff.
Thank your ratings in the process.
No. We started with 1,000. Now there's about 1,800 people watching. So it's actually gone up. I think once you leave is when it will go down, and then KV and me will talk for 5 minutes. That's when people will be like, screw this shit, I'm out.
It was fun. Yeah. Thanks, guys.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot. Really appreciate your time.
Okay.
KV, stick around. I just like 5 minutes. We'll do some time pass. Thank you so much. Okay. How's it going, man, KV? We never get to talk as human beings without all these.
Yeah. We're always talking with some like we're into threesomes. Now I have a fetish where we are like, oh man, we can't, it's not happening between the two of us. We need an extra.
By the way, today I was ashamed of you because you never quoted some absurd historical fact, but the ISIS thing was at least like, and by the way, you know what, like, this is where I realized the danger of any conversation happens, is that you mentioned ISIS and you said, hey, the positive side. And I was like, wait, don't go there, KV.
No.
I think we should mention that ISIS is terrible. They're one of the worst organization in the world.
Yeah.
And we don't stand by them. They're pieces of shit. Okay. We have to. Yeah. But he was talking about one facet of it from an archaeologist's perspective. Yeah. Threesome open chat. Now people are asking for it.
I can't imagine someone watching it and then listening to like big ass things like journalism and all that, and suddenly at some point threesome starts. They're like, what? The range covered in this podcast. But also as a comic, and sort of we can't help it, I know there are those feelings where we look for a joke somewhere. And then like that NDA thing I loved, you know, when he said, I've signed a non-disclosure, and I looked at you and I'm like, which one of you is going for it? Even at the end, when someone compared Srinivasan Jain to Kamal Hassan, I was like, this is the closest he'll ever get to BJP. Kamal Hassan. इतना जोर से वो आ रहा था मुझे, बट देन आई स्टॉप माय सेल्फ एंड लाइक ओके हिम लुकिंग लाइक
आई सेम आई वाज इन माय हेड आई वाज लाइक नोटिंग डाउन जोक्स इन माय माइंड वेयर आई एम लाइक there should be an NDTV reunion party, like it's a college, yeah. right? So they have a reunion yeah. where they call like a comedian yeah. Yeah. and they're yeah. confused about what and like it, dude, that would be a great TV show, man. And by the way, yeah. the one about, and again, I don't know why we're talking about ISIS again, but the one about ISIS or any organization like that dealing with paperwork is just yeah. an interesting, like it's such a dark comedy scenario where it's like, you imagine this terrible, horrific terrorist organization and they're just like, dude, you've not filed under Section 36G. We'll lose taxation. Like, that's just...
I had the same thought when he said yeah. like them. I was like, this is a sketch right there.
Yeah.
Where
yeah.
you have where these ISIS guys saying, photo state karana tha. Arre, yeah. Sign karna hai. You need triplicate signature. You need teen photocopy. Ispe sign. Attest karana hai. Attest. Saman nahi aa raha hai ke tere ko. Sir, main kal tak bomb phod raha tha. Sir, mujhe nahi pata.
It's like color kyun laya extra printer kam ho raha hai sara. This is so much stuff about ISIS. I think we should do this next time, it's like we get done with the guests and then we just have a 10 minute session of the jokes we missed.
Yeah for sure. It's one of those moments where you're like, gaye papa, chalo TV on karo. Chalo TV dekhenge baith kar. No pressure.
By the way, I think we should officially start calling you a co-host of this. And
I don't mind.
And we'll have to figure out the payment for this, which is
you'll send me a super chat, 40 rupees.
Dude, that's a good way to pay you. Next time you do a live, I'll come and give like 1,000 rupees on super chat. This is the deal. What are you up to, man? What is happening? How are the shows?
Quizzing with the comedians, that's the biggest thing. We had 8 quarterfinals on Friday and Saturday. The semifinals are starting right now, within the next 1.5 hours, 2 hours. Oh. And that's the most exciting part. And we have Kanan Gill, Tanmay Bhatt, Zakir Khan, Malika Dua, Biswa Kalyan Rath, Varun Grover, who have all made it to the semifinal. It's very, very exciting. Very exciting.
You know what?
Starting now.
See, this proves that you're a very likable person, okay? Because I saw the entire poster of all the comedians on that list. And two of those people have said no to me, saying that we are not doing any of these kind of shows.
Okay, get the hint, Saurabh.
Then I see the poster, I'm like, abhi to baat nahi kare.
It happened to me once in the last 3-4 months. But I talk to someone, he's like, nahi sir, mere paas nahi. And next day I see him on some YouTube, I'm like, man. Mere ko bol dena seedha yaar, we're close enough for you to just say ki mujhe nahi karna, what the
Okay, so KV is Quizzing with Comedians semi-final happening now at 2 o'clock it is, yeah?
2 o'clock, 2, 4, 6, 8 and then finals at 10 p.m.
And this is on Random Chicky Bum channel?
No, this is on Insider, like there are tickets and it's a Zoom show, which is a ticketed show.
Awesome.
But so anyone who is listening to this should know that this is a quiz show. That is a disclaimer that I make. It's not a comedy show. So don't come to see like jokes from comedians. There are no jokes. It's pure quizzing show.
I mean, there are jokes. It's not
there like, are jokes. There yeah. are jokes. But don't come for them. Jokes aa jaate hain side mein. But because invariably out of 100, 200 people, there's one, so 0.5% to 1% who will message me saying, "Arey, jokes." And I'm like, hey, dude, please. Jokes nahi hai isme, this is a quiz show.
Yeah, it's like you're going to watch a cricket match and you're like, cricket will be there, but you can also buy like a Bisleri bottle on the side, which is the comedy.
Correct. So, yeah, it's like someone coming to Virat Kohli and saying, yaar, century mara, lekin gaali nahi diya, yaar, main to gaali ke liye aaya tha. I'm like, excuse me, main idhar cricket khel raha hu, mera batting de, bakwaas. Gaali mil sakta hai as a bonus, but main focus is cricket.
Dude, I wanted to ask Srinivasan about this lady who was eating on Arnab show the other day, which is
that thought came in my mind. I was like, somebody will mention that.
I think that's a new trend to happen. Okay, so go check out Quizzing with Comedians. If you want to support, please support on Instamojo and PayPal. And I have a workshop for writing today at 6:30 p.m. if you want to come for that. I'm going to be talking about how you can write a book in India. It's a 90-minute thing, so don't expect that at the end of it you'll have a book. I'm just like talking about it. 7:30, 7:45 actually is I have Rant of the Pan 2020, which is all new content, which is all about COVID times, ranting nonsense. And yeah, that's about it, guys. And again, Tuesday, as I said, is going to be XNG, which is Varun Thakur and Adar Malik and Kautuk Shivastav and Neville Shah. Kumar, who's your favorite? Name them so everybody else feels bad.
Out of these four?
Yeah.
I'm closest to Varun Thakur as a friend. But very, very, like 0.5% difference with Neville. So Neville and Varun are my closest friends.
Fuck, dude. But, now Neville's going to feel bad. That's good.
No, Neville and I talk a lot, but Thakur and I have a, like, beyond comedy, we have a big, like, very close relationship.
Listen, I
think also, Neville... also both called Varun, so abhi itna aur kitna close.
Also, Neville should feel bad after he asked that question to Ramchandra Guha. I think he should feel bad about himself for the whole next 2 weeks. cool, that's about it. I'll see you guys on Tuesday. Yeah. And if you guys are coming for Quizzing with Varun, it keeps continuing. I've done the show. It's a lot of fun. If you enjoy quizzing, it's really good fun. And I'll see you today for the show. I'll see you today for this thing. Tickets are on saurabhpanth.com for my show. You can head there. And yeah, thanks a lot for everybody. Thanks for putting money on PayPal and Instamojo. And in the comments also, let me know who you'd like me to interview next. Goodbye. See you later. Have fun. Party hard.